guys, welcome to the first lecture on ARM microcontroller and embedded system. This is lecture 1, so I'll be covering some topics of module 3. So I'll be doing 2 or 3 lecture videos on the same module, so that it is easy to cover the sections in the module. So don't worry about the subject code, it is 15 EC or 17 EC, the syllabus is same. So for 17 scheme also the same syllabus. So you can see the topic is, the module name is Embedded System Components. So these are the topics that we will study. And you can see the textbook that you need to refer is text 2 in the prescribed books. So which is the text 2 is, it is Shibu KV, Introduction to Embedded Systems, Tata McGraw-Hill, 2nd edition. Right. So this is the textbook 2, and you can see not all the means for this particular module, module 3, which are the sections you have to refer. So what are the sections? All topics from chapter 1 and chapter 2. So of which textbook? This one, Shibu KV, Introduction to Embedded System. And in that you have to exclude the topics 2.3.3.4, 2.3.3.8 and 2.3.3.9. So these are not included. So apart from this, all other topics from chapter 1 and chapter 2 are included. See, if you don't have the textbook, no problem. Just refer the notes, whatever the notes that is available in my Google website, that is fine. So now we shall move on to the first topic here, introduction. So what is an embedded system? So since we are talking about an embedded system, so first we shall see what is an embedded system. So the definition, so there are various definitions. So this is one of the definitions for embedded system. An electronic or electromechanical system which is designed to perform a specific function and is a combination of both hardware and firmware. So what is a firmware? Firmware is nothing but a software. So this is the definition for an embedded system. As I told, there are many definitions. This is one of the definitions. So he says it is a combination of both hardware and software. This is very important. So it is not a software or it is not just a hardware. So what are the examples? So where you can quote n number of examples. So you can see electronic toys. So mobiles, mobile is also an embedded system. So washing machine, AC. So a set-top box, DVD player, so all these are embedded systems. So this is a basic definition. So and next is, the embedded systems are unique in character and behavior. So they have unique characters and behavior. So what do you mean by unique? Means, see, suppose I take an example of a DVD player, which is an embedded system. So it is unique in the sense it can only play CDs or DVDs, right? It cannot, let's say, play a floppy disk. No, it is not meant to play the floppy disk. It is only meant to play CDs or DVDs. So that is what is unique. So it is unique in its way. It plays only CDs and DVDs. So that is what is unique. Okay. So now next we'll come to the how do you differentiate between embedded system and a general computing system? Embedded system and general computing system. So you can see the two sections here, general purpose system and embedded system. So for the first point of difference is, so in a general purpose system, it's a system which is combination of generic hardware. See the difference here, generic hardware. So generic means that hardware is capable of performing many functions, not unique function as compared to embedded system, generic. It is capable of performing many functions. So that is why it is known as generic. And general purpose OS, so along with generic hardware, general purpose operating system. Okay, so to execute, see, to execute a variety of applications. So it is not meant to do only one application. So it is meant to execute a variety of applications. That is what is general purpose system. So a very typical example is your PC. So that is what a comment, I have added a comment here. So example is PC, personal computer or laptop. So in your laptop, so you can, you can play videos, you can play MP3 or you can songs, you can do video editing, You can perform word editing, you can create an Excel file, Word file. You can play movies. You can play games. Okay, you can also use it for networking. So all the applications. So it is a variety of applications. That is what is a general purpose system. It is PC example. So now coming on to embedded system. So it is a system which is combination of special purpose hardware. So see the difference. Generic hardware here. But here it is special purpose hardware because this is a hardware special purpose because it is capable of doing or it is intended to do only say specific application. Okay, like example is DVD player. Only play CDs and DVDs, nothing else. And it may also include an embedded OS for executing this particular specific set of applications. So for a specific application it requires a specific operating system. So it is an embedded OS is not a general purpose OS which supports all the functionalities. So this embedded OS will always support limited functionalities which is needed for that particular application, that's all. Okay, so an example I have coded is ATM. So we all used ATMs. So ATMs are only supposed to do a specific set of applications like vending the cash, or you can even deposit the cash, fine, and you can change your pin or you can check your balance, that's all. But it is not meant to play games. Okay, so ATM you cannot play games, correct? So hence specific set of applications, that is what is embedded, targeted for a particular application. So next difference is, so it contains GPOS as we talked in the first point itself. So some examples of general purpose OS are Windows and Linux. So we already think you're already familiar with Windows and Linux, right? So these are GPOS. So now moving on to the embedded part. So it may or may not contain an OS. So there are certain applications which may not demand OS. Example, a toy car, a remote control toy car, so which doesn't need a OS. So in that case no OS is employed. But there are certain applications where you may need a OS. Okay, so example, Symbian. So I have coded a OS here, Symbian. So this is a embedded OS which was employed in old Nokia phones, the keypad Nokia phones, correct? So wherein a OS was required. So you may have OS or you may not have OS. If you require OS, it is an embedded OS, not a GPOS. So next point is applications are alterable. So see the here, programmable by the user. So it is possible for the end user to reinstall the OS and add or remove user applications. So again, the typical example is your PC. So you can install any application you want. Suppose you want to install a PDF viewer, you can install it. You want to edit a PDF, you can install a new application for that. So you want to play let's say media, so you can install application for that. Once you install it, you can uninstall it. So everything is alterable, general purpose. But coming to embedded, so the firmware of embedded system is pre-programmed and it is not alterable by the end user. So firmware here, he means it is a OS. If it is a OS, is employed, it is OS. That is why it is firmware. So see the name firmware. Firm means you cannot alter the code. You cannot alter the OS. So once it is programmed, the user cannot reprogram it. Example is your mobile phone OS. Suppose you are using an Android phone. So that Android OS cannot be reprogrammed to whatever you want. Okay, it is already pre-programmed, but you can update it, but that update again comes from the manufacturer itself. You cannot alter the OS. So that is what is the point here. Next one, performance. Performance is key deciding factor on selection of the system. So the philosophy is always faster is better. So that is what we desire, right? So whenever you select a PC or a laptop, you want it to respond very fast. Okay, so that is the deciding parameter, performance. So the faster is the better. So that is what is the thing in general purpose systems. But coming to this Remember, application-specific requirements, so like performance, power requirement, memory usage, so all these come into the deciding factors. Not only performance, but power requirement is also required. One example is your again mobile phone. So suppose you mean someone designs a mobile phone which requires, let's say, 20 watts to just operate. Okay, so that is not feasible. Mobile phone should operate, let's say, with a power requirement of 4 to 5 watts. So that is what the battery is capable of providing. It can provide 20 watts, right? So power requirement is also the key thing, like that. So that is what. So next feature is, so less or not at all tailored towards reducing operating power requirements. So that is, in general purpose systems, there are very less or no low power modes. So that is what is the meaning of this. No low power modes, because power is not a constraint in the general purpose systems. Example is your PC. Okay, so it operates on AC voltage, direct plugged into the power supply. So there is no power constraint. But that is not the case in embedded systems. So an embedded system is highly tailored to take the advantage of power saving modes by hardware and OS, because power is very limited. So again, coming to your laptop, or sorry, the mobile phone application, which is an embedded system. So what if the battery of your mobile phone drains off in just 2 hours? Okay, which is not again feasible, right? At least you expect it to give you a battery backup for 1.5 to 2 hours, sorry, 2 days, 1.5 to 2 days. That is feasible. So for that, there are power saving modes. We already studied some power saving instructions in module 2. Okay, so put the processor in sleep, put the processor to wait for an event, so wherein which saves the power. So unless that event takes place, the power processor will not wake up. Next, response requirements are not time critical. That is what it says in general purpose system. So example is your PC. Suppose you want to play a song in your PC, you double click on the PC, sorry, on that particular song. So let's say it take 2 seconds to start playing the song. Fine. And some other day, if you want to play the same song, if you double click on it, let's say it may take 5 to 6 seconds to start to play the song. So that is what the response requirements are not time critical. So even though the song starts to play, let's say 2 or 3 seconds late, it doesn't matter. Okay, it will not have any serious effect. Okay, so that is what is the response requirement, not time critical. Okay. But whenever it is embedded system, for certain category of systems, like mission critical systems, the response time is highly critical. So example is the braking systems, the anti-lock braking systems in your four-wheelers or two-wheelers. So as soon as you apply brake, the brake has to respond, let's say, within 1 second of the applying of the brake, right? So every time you apply the brake, it is 1 second. It has to respond in 1 second. It is not like it, some days it responds 1 second. For some other day, it will take 5 seconds to respond. So that is not the case, because here, if the response is slow, so someone might lose his or her life. Okay, so that is what is an embedded system. The time response is critical. So next is, need not be deterministic in execution. So that is what. Some day the song plays in 2 seconds. Some day the song takes 10 seconds. So it is not deterministic execution. But here, execution behavior should be deterministic. So that is, whenever you apply brake, it has to respond in 1 second. Any day, any time, 24 hours, 24 by 7. Okay, so it has to respond in 1 second. So these are the differences. So now we'll move on to the classification of embedded systems. So how are these embedded systems classified? So they are classified based on these four categories. First is based on generation, next is complexity and performance requirement, Next is deterministic behavior, and the last one is the triggering. So first we shall see based on generation how they are classified. So the embedded systems are classified as first generation. So what are these first generation? So these embedded systems were built around 8-bit microprocessors like 8085 and Z80. So you already studied 8086 processor in your fourth semester, right? So now this 8085, it's a predecessor of 8086, which was a 8-bit processor. So whichever embedded system that was designed on 8-bit processors or 4-bit microcontrollers, so those were classified as first generation. So second generation, so these are the embedded systems built around 8 or 16-bit microcontrollers and 16-bit microprocessors. So you can see the complexity has increased here from 8-bit, it is 16-bit. Okay, so that is why they are classified into second generation. And next, the third generation, so they will even get more complex. So these are systems built around 16 to 32-bit microprocessor or controllers. So whatever the ARM processor, ARM Cortex M3, it's a 32-bit processor. So if you use ARM Cortex M3 to build an embedded system, so that will be under third generation, let's say third generation. So coming on to the last one, so built around system on chips, SoCs. Okay, so example is your mobile phone. So whatever the motherboard of the mobile phone, it is known as system on chip, because whatever that system requires, whatever the mobile phone requires, everything is available on a single chip. So that is why it is known as system on chip. So those will come under fourth generation. And you can even use reconfigurable processors and multi-core processors. Suppose you use a FPGA to build an embedded system, so that is reconfigurable. So you already studied in fifth semester in HDL that the same FPGA kit can be used for building a half adder, full adder, okay, a multiplexer. So it is reconfigured. That is fourth generation. So next we'll come to classification based on complexity and performance. So based on this, they are classified into three types: so small scale, medium scale, and large scale. So what is small scale? So these are the systems which are simple in application and needs, and where performance requirements are not at all time critical. So example is your toy car, so where performance is not time critical. So they are usually built around low performance. So this is here, low performance and low cost microprocessor controllers. So again, example is electronic toy. Next is medium scale. So this are slightly complex in hardware and software compared to the small scale. So they are built around medium performance, again low cost controllers, or you can also use DSPs, digital signal processors, right? And it may contain an embedded OS also. So this small scale doesn't contain an embedded OS. So next one is large scale or complex. So these involve highly complex hardware and firmware requirements. The example is your automatic deployment of airbags in four-wheelers, or the anti-lock braking systems, or the missile guidance systems. So these are complex embedded systems. So you can see these are employed in mission critical applications. Okay, demanding very high performance. So these are usually built around 32 or 30 64 bit processors or controllers. Okay, so this is a classification. So next we will move on to the major application areas of embedded systems. So I've added a comment here. You can see the comment everywhere. So nowadays you can find an embedded system everywhere. Okay, so the applications are not limited, they are everywhere. So first application is consumer electronics. So example, camcorders, cameras, your TVs, DVD players. So next, household appliances. So TV, DVD players, washing machine, fridge, oven, microwave oven, and ACs. Right? Next, home automation and security. So home automation, so ACs, sprinklers, so intruder detection alarms, closed circuit, that is CCTV cameras, okay, fire alarms. So all these come under home automation. So next is automotive industry, so industrial applications. So as I told you, anti-lock braking systems, ABS, engine control, ignition systems, navigation systems, so these control come under automotive. So next is telecom. So what are the telecom applications? One is the mobile phones, okay, so some switches, handset, multimedia applications, etc. So next is computer peripherals. So as soon as it is peripheral, so it is printers, scanners, fax machines, keyboards, mouse, everything. So computer networking. So networking, as soon as it is networking, it is routers, switches, firewalls, etc. Next, healthcare. So healthcare is, so scanners. Scanners means it can be X-ray scanner. There's EEG or ECG machines. Okay, patient monitoring systems. So everything comes under healthcare. Next is measurement and instrumentation. So digital multimeters. So you might have used this digital multimeters, digital CROs. You already used this in the fifth semester, HDL lab, digital CROs for the analog to digital conversions, right? The next, logic analyzers. So next is banking and retail. So ATM, currency counters, POS, point of sales machine. So this is POS. We already use these POS everywhere. So suppose you buy something in the, let's say in a more shop, and you don't have a cash but you have a card, so you can swipe there your card so that you can make the payment. That is what is POS, point of sale. So next is card readers. So barcode, smart readers, handheld devices. So you might have seen these in the large scale malls, wherein there are barcode scanners everywhere. So these are the applications. As I told, they are everywhere. Okay. So next coming to the purpose. So the embedded systems may be built for different purposes. So the first purpose you can see is data collection, storage, representation. Okay, so this is the first purpose. So performs acquisition of some data from the external world. Collected data can be either analog or digital. Okay, and the data collected is usually stored for analysis, manipulation, and transmission. Okay, so a typical example for data collection is your digital camera. Okay, so the collected data may be stored directly. So suppose it is a memory card. So whatever the image that you take or the video, can store it in the memory card, or maybe transmitted to some other system. So examples is nowadays the cameras come with Wi-Fi or NFC, where you can transmit the data to your mobile phone or a laptop or a PC. Okay, and then once the information is extracted, it can be deleted. Right, this is a typical example. So next purpose can be data communication. So as soon as it is data communication, so it is a router, a wireless router or a wired router. You should take this into picture. So as soon as it is data communication, so these are deployed in applications ranging from satellite communication to simple home networking systems also. So even you can include the satellite also here. So next, embedded data communication systems are dedicated for data communication. So example, so Ethernet, RS-232, okay, or here Wi-Fi, GPS, GSM, Bluetooth, ZigBee, so everything comes. Okay, so this is the second one. So next purpose may be data signal processing. Okay, signal processing applications. So can you think of a signal processing application? So example is an hearing aid. So you might have seen this, someone might use this hearing aid, right? So those who can't hear properly, so they make use of this. it is data processing. So what is the processing done here? So here an analog signal is taken, which is the voice signals, the speech signal, and that speech signal will be converted to electrical signals so that they can be heard properly. Okay, they can be heard properly by the whoever is using it. So there is some processing going on. It is not just storing the data, it is processing. They are doing some processing, like amplification, okay, removal of noise. So all these are processing. As you can see here, signal processing functionalities are employed, like speech coding synthesis, audio video transmissions, etc. So these are computationally intensive systems, so you cannot easily prepare an hearing aid. Okay, so they will usually have a digital signal processor, because it is dealing with signal processing, so obviously you should have a digital signal processor. So next application, or next purpose, may be monitoring. So what is monitoring? So as soon as you see monitoring, so you should think of a monitoring application. So it can be speed control, so you are monitoring the speed of let's say a vehicle, so it is a speed monitoring, speed control. Okay, or you are monitoring, let's say, a temperature of a room. So you should, let's say the temperature should be 30 degrees, so you have to regularly monitor whether the temperature is 30 degrees or not. If it crosses 30 degrees or if it is below 30 degrees, what should happen? That is what is monitoring. So also another example is patient monitoring system. So you can see the patient monitoring system. So you might have seen these in the ICUs. Okay, so nowadays in the news they show the ICUs, right? So patient monitoring systems. So what they will do, they will monitor particular patient vitals. So example is, they might monitor ECG, or they might monitor the heartbeat. Okay, they might monitor the oxygen content in the blood. Okay, so all these are measuring monitoring. So other examples are digital CROs, multimeters. Okay, so they also can come under control and instrumentation application monitoring. So next is control. Yeah, this is just monitoring, but they don't do any control application. They just monitor. Suppose speed monitoring. So you monitor the vehicle speed, that's all. But if it crosses the speed limit, or what should happen? So that is not taken care by the monitoring. So that comes to the control. This is the control here. So example is AC, air pressure, speed of rotation. So suppose, as I told you, you want to monitor the temperature of a room, let's say 30 degrees is the desired temperature. So what should happen if it is not 30 degrees, if it is above 30 degrees? So you should bring back the temperature to 30 degrees. So how will you do that? So you employ a cooling system so that the temperature comes down. So that is what is control. So functionality is used for imposing control over the some variables. So what are these variables? So variables can be temperature, pressure, speed. Okay, so how do you control them? Using sensors and actuators. So sensors for monitoring and actuators for controlling it. So sensors are connected to input boards and actuators are connected to output boards. So you already see. Yeah, so sensors connected to input boards, actuators to output boards. We have already seen these in the embedded lab, wherein we can configure a port to be output or input, and we have used an LED to be an output and a simple switch as an input, correct? So this is what sensor is, an input device, and actuator is an output device. So example is given is an AC for controlling the temperature of a room. So next is application specific user interface. What is this? So example given is, you can see an old keypad Nokia phone. So this phone will have a user interface. So what is a user interface means? It is graphical user interface. So as soon as you boot up your mobile phone, so you'll see the welcome screen, and then you'll see the icons, correct? So if you click on the icon, so let's say it is a icon for the contact manager, so you click on it, You will go to the contact manager. It will show what are the contacts you are having. So if you want to delete the contact, you want to copy the contact. So what is this? These options that you get, these are nothing but the user interfaces. Okay. So every application will have its own user interface. Example, an user interface of an ATM machine. Okay. So you are already using an ATM machine. So once you go into an ATM machine, so you can see the user interface. What are the options? So once you insert the card, it will ask you to enter the PIN. Then the options might be change PIN, okay, get a mini statement, show the balance, fine. So change your PIN, change your mobile number. So these are the options. This is the interface for ATM. So the same interface may not be applicable for a mobile phone. Okay, so a mobile phone will have a different interface. So what are the interfaces in mobile phone? So you will have a home screen, you will have a back button, you will have a recent button, okay, right? So you will have a let's say an option for inserting or editing the wallpaper. So those options are not available in ATM, correct? So that is what you mean by application specific user interface. So for every application there is a particular user interface. So all applications will not have the same interface, right? So these are the purposes of embedded system. So now we'll move into a typical embedded system. So what an embedded system will contain? So I'll directly skip on to the diagram. So you can see this is the typical embedded system. So what this embedded system will contain? So first we'll come to this. The heart of the embedded system is the system core. So what is this system core? You can see here. This core can be an FPGA, that is field programmable gate array, or it can be a ASIC application specific integrated circuit, or it can be a digital signal processor, or it can be a system on chip, or it can be a microprocessor or microcontroller. So this is the heart of the system, the processing core, system core. Okay. So apart from the system core, only the core cannot do the operation. So what else it will have? So it requires some memory, right? So suppose it's a mobile phone, to operate it requires some memory. It can be the primary memory or the secondary memory. So that is what is memory. You can see the memory here. So this memory, what it might contain? It might contain the embedded firmware. So as I told, embedded firmware is nothing but the OS. The instructions that are required for the application. Suppose it's an AC application, so you have to write some code for the AC application to control the temperature. So if the temperature goes beyond 30, what should happen? If it goes above 30, what should happen? So those are the instructions you have to write. Where you will write, where you will store them? In the memory. So we will discuss what are the types of memories later. Okay. So then what else extra is required? Communication interfaces. So communication interfaces are very important. Why? Because suppose you want to send a data that you have collected to somewhere else. So how will you send them? So you need an interface. So it can be a wireless interface, it can be a Bluetooth, it can be a Wi-Fi, Zigbee. So those are the communication interfaces. They can be wired as well as wireless. We shall see what are the different interfaces later. Okay. So next is the input and outputs. So inputs are sensors and outputs are actuators, because every embedded system requires inputs. So again, if you come to the AC application, what is the input? So it is the input is temperature. So how will you sense the temperature? You require a temperature sensor. So that is the input. So it acts as the input. And next, system core. So next is the output. Fine. So you sense the temperature, and the temperature is above 30. What should happen? So you should bring down the temperature to 30. How will you bring down? You have to cool the room temperature. How will you cool down temperature? So you have to actuate, or you have to switch on the fan. Let's say you have to turn on the fan. Okay, or you have to turn on the cooling system. So how will you turn on that? Using an output port, an actuator. The output may be a fan here. You are monitoring the temperature, or the output may be a LED. So these are the inputs and outputs. So we shall discuss what are the types of inputs and outputs, outputs that are used in an embedded system. Along with this, other supporting integrated circuits and subsystems are also required. So what might be other supporting systems? So example is a watchdog timer. Okay, so I had given an example of this. Watchdog timer is used to or it is the main use of watchdog timer is to prevent the system from hanging. Okay, suppose the system hangs, it has to come out of that wherever it has struck, so it can come out of it using the watchdog timer. Right, so that is the extra integrated circuit that is required. So apart from that, what are the other integrated circuits? It can be oscillator. So why do you require oscillator? You to generate the clock pulses, because every system requires clock. That is how it works, right? It has to have some reference. So the oscillator will come, so which is a supporting structure. Okay. So now, so this is the main, or you can say real world various components that are used in embedded systems. So that is what is, whatever I just explained is available here. You can go through that. So now what we'll do is we'll discuss individual components in detail. So first we'll discuss the system core. So what is the system core? So these are, system core can be any one of these. So we shall discuss these in detail. So the core of the embedded system. So what can be the core? It can be a general purpose and domain specific processors. So as I told, the core can be a microprocessor, it can be a microcontroller, or it can be a digital signal processor. Or the core can also be programmable logic devices. So can you give an example of programmable logic device? The example is FPGA or CPLD. So the CPLD we have already used in the fifth semester HDL lab. Okay, CPLD. So it can be configured to implement any functionality. That is what is programmable. So you can program it. Same chip can be programmed n number of times. So next, the core can be an ASIC, application specific integrated circuit, and this can also be COTS. So we shall see what are these. So next topic is general purpose processor versus application specific processor. So what are the differences between these two? So a general purpose, as the name itself indicates, general purpose processor or GPP is a processor for designed for general computing tasks. So that processor should be able to execute any task. Example is your Intel processor. So the Intel CPUs, i3, i5, i7. Okay. So all these are general purpose processors. They are capable of doing any task. It is able to process video signals, it is able to process audio signals, it can even process gaming applications, correct? You can even edit videos, any application. So GPPs are produced in large volumes and they are targeted for general market. So these Intel processors, they are produced in large volumes. It is not like you place the order and then the company manufactures the product and then gives you. No, it is not like that. So they manufacture them in, let's say, millions of units. They are already available. You can go to a shop, just procure it, that's so large volumes. So next is, due to high volume production, the per unit cost of the chip is lower compared to the application specific. Okay, so a typical general purpose system general purpose processor contains an ALU and a control unit. So this is about general purpose processor. So now coming to application specific processors. As the name itself indicates, it is application specific, it is not general purpose. Suppose you want to play only audio songs or MP3 songs, so you can manufacture a processor for doing that, only to play audio songs, but it cannot play video. Okay, so that is why it is known as application specific. It is only specific for audio applications, correct? So that is what is application specific. So see, you can see here, the architecture and instruction set are optimized to specific application. So whatever the processor you design, it will only be capable of, or it will have only the hardware that is required for playing MP3 files, that's all. it will not have the hardware for playing the let's say video files. No. So examples are network processing, automotive, telecom, media applications. So these are all application specific applications. Right? So that is what is application specific. So the need for ASIP arises when traditional general purpose processors are unable to meet the increasing application needs. Okay, so when a general purpose system cannot handle a particular task, you go for application specific processor, which can handle only that particular task you want to handle. So some ASIPs are manufactured by the manufacturers AVR. Okay, so you can see the manufacturer is Atmel. Next, system on chips also come under ASIPs. Digital signal processors are also examples of ASIPs, application specific integrated processors. Okay, so this is about the difference. So this can be asked. Compare the general purpose processors and application purpose integrated processors. So next is microprocessor. So we already learned this in your first semester. So what is this? It is a CPU, so which is capable of performing arithmetic as well as logical operation according to predefined instructions. Okay, so there are certain predefined instructions. So you might remember some instructions of 8086, like move or add, multiply, increment. So these are application, so these are specific to a processor. So the same instructions may not be available for, let's say, ARM processor. Okay, it might have a different format, different instruction. So that is what is microprocessor. Yes, as I was saying, so this microprocessor or the CPU, so it is also called a CPU. It usually contains an ALU, a control unit, and some working registers. So the components in a microprocessor, or you can say the hardware in the microprocessor, is very limited. Okay, so it is a highly dependent unit. It is a highly dependent unit. If you remember the 8086 processor from the fourth semester, so you might remember that the registers are very limited there, right? So it doesn't have much of the memory. If you want memory, you have to interface an external memory chip. Okay, and the IO ports also, the input output ports also for the microprocessor are limited. So if you want to increase the ports, again you have to go for a one more hardware so that the number of ports are increased. So that is what it is, a highly dependent unit, and it requires combination of other hardware like memory, a timer unit, and controller, interrupt controller unit, etc. for the function. So it is a highly dependent unit. So Intel was the first to manufacture the microprocessor 4004. So you can see it is a 4-bit processor. Okay, so way back in 1971. So nowadays you can see where is 4-bit and where is 64-bit. Already 64-bit processors are available, right? So this is what. So I have a diagram for this, for microprocessor and a controller. So you can see this is the microprocessor to the left of the screen. So you can see this is the CPU. So what is the CPU will contain? An ALU, a control unit, and some registers. That's all, working registers. But you can see the timers. If you want a timer, you have to interface it externally. You know, for the IO ports you have to interface, the output you have to interface, so serial interface, this is the RAM and ROM memory, so all these are external interfaces. So this is CPU is a highly dependent unit. So now moving on to the microcontroller. So it is you can say the advanced version of a processor. So it is highly targeted or highly integrated silicon chip consisting of a CPU. So it consists of CPU. So what is a CPU? CPU is nothing but a microprocessor. What is CPU will contain? An ALU, control unit, and register. So it contains the CPU. Along with this CPU, it has a RAM. So it has some memory, which the processor didn't have. So now this controller has some memory. And along with that, it has some additional registers also. So along with working resistance, it is also having some additional resistors. And along with that, it is having on-chip RAM or ROM. Okay, so some storage is also available, and along with the timer and interrupt controller units are also available, and the dedicated input-output ports are also available. So we can see the difference here. So I can say that a controller is nothing but it's a processor, but along with the processor, it is also having extra hardware. What are the extra hardware? The memory, the I/O ports, the registers, the timer and controller units, extra. So I have the diagram for this also, same diagram. So you can see to the right, you can see microcontroller. So it is CPU on a single chip. So it has a CPU. So along with CPU, it has memory, it has timer, it has RAM, ROM, some interfaces and input-output device. So all these are on a single chip. You need not interface anything else. But here, for a processor, you can see these are not on the single chip. They are separate. They are to be interfaced. But this controller has all these on a single chip. Okay? So that is what is a controller. So it can be considered as a, you can see a controller can be considered as a superset of microprocessor, because along with whatever processor has, it has something else, something extra. So that is why it is known as superset. So very popular microcontroller was 8051, so which is still used in some applications today also. Okay, so again, there are various manufacturers like Intel, AVR, Atmel, whatever. So next is, since a microcontroller contains all the necessary functional blocks for independent working, they found a greater place in embedded domain. So since you need not interface anything, everything required is already there for some extent, so they are more popular and they are more cheap, because that is why they were popular. So one more manufacturer is Texas Instruments, which manufactures the processor, sorry, controller. So now, so there are the differences between processor and controller, whatever I told. So same thing is now tabulated, that's all. So you can see a silicon chip here. So microprocessor is a silicon chip or a CPU which is capable of performing arithmetic as well as logical operations according to predefined set of instructions. So next, a microcontroller is a highly integrated chip. Contains, so what it contains, CPU along with CPU, the external RAM, so the RAM, ROM, whatever the interrupt control units, dedicated I/O ports, everything, timers. You can see the basic definition. So next difference is, it is a dependent unit. What is, which one? Microprocessor, dependent unit. It requires all the extra integrated circuits, but this microcontroller is a self-contained unit and it doesn't require anything extra, because everything is already there on the chip. So that is why it is a superset of microprocessor. Next is, most of time general purpose in design and operation. So processors, microprocessors are general purpose in design. So example, as I told, Intel processors, they are general purpose in design. So they should be capable of handling any application. But microcontrollers are not general purpose, they are application specific or domain specific, like what we discussed as ASIPs, application specific integrated processors. So it is a microcontroller. Next, doesn't contain built-in I/O port. If you want I/O port, so you have to use an external chip. What is that chip? 8255. So using this 8255, you can increase the number of input ports. So basically 8086 has only 8 bit ports. So if you want to convert that 8 bits to, let's say, a 16 bit port, you have to use 8255. But here the I/O ports are built in, and usually the ports are from varying from 8 to 16 bits or 32 bit ports. So they are targeted for high end market. Okay, but this controllers, they are targeted for embedded market, not high end, embedded market. So next, microprocessors have limited power saving modes. Why? Because they are general purpose and they usually run on direct power. The the AC power. So example is again your PC. So the processor there runs on the power supply, which so hence no power saving modes are required. But a controller, it usually runs on battery. It doesn't directly run on a AC power. It runs on battery, and since the battery power is very limited, so power saving is necessary. So it has power saving features. This is the difference. So next, we will move on to the next system core that can be used in an embedded system, which is digital signal processor. So suppose you don't want to use a microprocessor or a controller, you want to use a DSP. So what might be the application wherein you want to use a DSP as a system core? As we already discussed, an example is hearing aid. So for hearing aid, so there is too much processing involved, because whenever you involve a voice signal, so there is too much processing involved. Because voice signal, the amplification should be done, the noise should be removed. So such applications require a signal processor. So then you go for signal processor. So what are these? These are special purpose, powerful 8, 16 or 32-bit processors designed specifically to meet computational demands and power concerns for audio, video and communication applications. So whenever it is audio, video and communication, it is DSPs that will do the job. So they are 2 to 3 times faster than the general purpose processors in signal processing applications. Okay, wherever signal processing is employed. So DSPs implement algorithm in hardware. So the algorithms are implemented in hardware, not software. So that is why they are much faster compared to general purpose processors. Because in general purpose processors, the algorithms are implemented in software. You write a code for implementing a algorithm. Suppose the algorithm is to find the GCD of two numbers. You write a code for GCD of two numbers. That is not the case in DSPs. They implement the code in hardware. So hardware is always faster than software. So what are the computational operations that DSPs perform? Addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. Okay, so what this DSPs will have, it has a program memory, data memory, the computational engine. So that is nothing but the hardware like CPU, an adder, subtractor, even a multiplier built in. Okay, so this is DSP. So now we'll talk about RISC versus CISC. So reduced instruction set computer versus complex instruction set computer. What are the differences? So RISC processors will have lesser number of instructions, and CISC will have more number of instructions. So instruction pipelining and increased execution speed in RISC, but CISC will not have any pipelining feature. So next, so RISC, the data is handled, the operations take place on registers, okay, not memory. So directly the operation will not take place on memory. The operations will be performed on registers. But in CISC, it is non-orthogonal, which means the operations can take place on memory also. It doesn't mean that the data should always be available in registers. The data can also be available in memory, and still the operation can be done. See, the operations are performed only on registers. The memory operations that are performed are only load and store, but that is not the case in CISC. So operations are performed on registers or memory depending on the type of instruction. And large number of instructions are available. So here, limited number of general purpose registers are available. So here the registers are more where in RISC, but here the registers, number of registers are less in CISC. Next, programmer needs to write more code. So why we require more code? Because the instructions in RISC, in the RISC, RISC are very less. So to implement a complex instruction, you have to write more code. But in CISC, that is not the case. There are many instructions available and the instructions are complex also. So hence the code is reduced. Next, suppose I'll give you an example on the code length. Suppose you want to implement multiplication in RISC. So since the instructions are limited, there is no multiply instruction directly available in RISC. So to multiply, let's say 2 4 times, you have to add 2 4 times. So you have to write add four times in RISC, but that is not the case in CISC. You directly have a multiply instruction. You just use simple multiply instruction. So one multiply instruction is sufficient. So that is why it says more code is written here in RISC, but less code is written in CISC. Next is single fixed length instructions, variable length instructions. So there is less silicon usage and pin count, more silicon usage and pin count. So usually RISC is in Harvard architecture, uses Harvard, and CISC can be either Harvard or Von Neumann. We shall see what is Harvard and Von Neumann, but if by the time you should already know the concept of Harvard and Von Neumann. So next comes programming logical devices. What is this? So suppose I don't want to make use of processor or controller or a DSP as the system core. I want to make a programmable, or I want to use a programmable device as a system core. So what is the use of this? The same programmable logic device can be programmed to implement any logic. So I'd given an example of HDL lab for this. So where in the CPLD there in the kit that you use, the same CPLD can be configured to act as a half adder or a full adder or a multiplexer or a demultiplexer or a parallel adder or a subtractor or a multiplier. So whatever the logic you require, the CPLD can be configured to perform that logic. So that is why they are known as programmable logic devices. Okay. So provide specific functions including device to device interfacing, data communication, signal processing, data display, timing control, operations, everything. So logic devices can be classified into two categories, fixed and programmable. Circuits in fixed logic device are permanent. They perform one function or set of functions. Once manufactured, they cannot be changed. So again, programmable devices, so there are two types, fixed and programmable. Fixed means it is one time programmable. Okay, so you will get a device, you can program it only once, but again you cannot reprogram it. So that is what is fixed. Okay, so in PLDs there is one more type which is programmable. So programmable means you can reprogram the same chip any number of times. So that is what is programmable. So offers customers a wide range of logic capacity, features, speed, voltage characteristics, and these can be reconfigured any number of times. So that is the advantage. You can reconfigure it any number of times until you get it correct. Okay. So next, designers can use inexpensive software tools to quickly develop, simulate, and test the logic on PLDs. So since they are reprogrammable, you can implement the logic any number of times until the logic that you are trying to implement is perfect. Okay. Yeah, so the rewritable memory technology, PLDs, that is what they will use. So examples are FPGAs, CPLDs. Okay. So some theories there, just go on. So FPGAs are more complex compared to CPLDs, and FPGAs can implement much complex systems compared to CPLDs. As you can see, CPLDs offer smaller logic gate counts, about 10,000 gates, that's all. But FPGAs can go up to 1 lakh gates, 1 lakh, 2 lakh, 4 lakh, 10 lakh gates. So more the number of gates, more is the logic that you can implement. That is the concept. So next, system core that you can use is application specific integrated circuit, ASIC. Okay. So suppose you don't want a microprocessor, you don't want to use a microcontroller, you don't want to use a DSP, or you don't want to use a PLD. So then you can go for ASICs. What is this? It is nothing but a microcontroller only. So you can see it is a microchip designed to perform specific or unique application. It is used as a replacement for conventional general purpose logic chips. So ASICs integrates several functions into a single chip and thereby reduces system development cost. So again, whatever the application demands is available on the single chip. So the next version of ASIC is system on chip. Okay, system on chip. So example I'd given is the motherboard of a mobile phone. So that is the next version of ASIC. So this as single chips, ASICs consume very small area and help the designer to design small systems. So mobile phone, how small is it? You can just imagine. Okay, so suppose the ASICs were not small enough, so the mobile phone, the size would go up. That is what. So these are prefabricated for special application, or it can be custom fabricated. Okay, using reusable building block. So how these ASICs will be implemented is, or the system on chips will be implemented is, so whatever the components used on these SoCs or the ASICs, they are not custom made, they are already available. Suppose you want to come up with a new mobile phone, what that mobile phone vendor will do is, he will purchase the microprocessor from let's say Snapdragon, he will purchase the memory from let's say Philips, he will purchase the battery from some other vendor, he will purchase the RAM from some other vendor, he will purchase the camera sensors from some other vendor. So what he will do is, he will purchase all these and he will just assemble it, that's all. So that is what you mean by reusable building blocks. So the blocks are already available, you have to just procure them and you have to just assemble them, that is what. Okay, so that is what is ASICs. So next, the last type of system core that can be used is COTS, or commercially off the shelf component. So you can see here, these can be used as is, that is, they are already available in the market, you can purchase it and use it, but you cannot customize it. Okay, remember this, you cannot customize it. So example is, you go to a market and suppose you want to buy a charger, mobile phone charger, already there are many various vendors, just go to the shop, purchase a mobile charger, that's all. So you can purchase it and use it, but you cannot reconfigure the charger. So let's say the charger is giving an output of 5 volts 1 ampere, so it will give 5 volt 1 ampere only, you cannot reconfigure it to be 5 volt 2 amperes or 5 volt 3 amperes. Okay, so that is what. So these are designed in such a way to provide easy integration and interoperability. Example, one more example is a keyboard, a USB keyboard. So USB keyboard is already available in the market, just bring the keyboard and use it. Okay, that's all. But you cannot change the keyboard layout, you cannot add extra keys, you cannot remove the keys. Okay, that is what, use it as is, as it is. Okay, so other examples are remote control toy car, the RF circuit, the ADCs, some ADCs available in the market, directly you can purchase it and use it, but you cannot change the operation, you can just use it. Suppose it is a 8-bit ADC, you can use it as a 8-bit ADC only, you cannot change it to 16-bit ADC. Yeah, so COTS in turn contains, what COTS contains is, it will contain a GPP, or it contains an ASIP, or it contains an ASIC. Okay, so you can see COTS is nothing but, it's a combination of all these devices. So now we'll come to this Harvard architecture versus Von Neumann architecture. So what is the difference? So we came across this, right, in the previous section. Now we shall see what are the differences. So the first difference is, in Harvard architecture, separate buses are used for instruction and data fetching. But in Von Neumann, a single shared bus is used for instruction and data fetching. So there is a diagram here, you can see Harvard and Von Neumann. So you can see in Harvard, there is separate data bus and there is separate address bus. Okay, so separate buses are there and separate memories are there. But in Von Neumann, what will happen is, the same bus is used for data access as well as the address instruction access. So next, the Harvard architecture is easier to pipeline. Why? Because there are separate buses. So since pipelining is used for improving the performance, so the performance goes up whenever it is Harvard. So low performance compared to Harvard. So this is high cost, which is Harvard. Why? Because you have to have separate buses. Separate buses means separate hardware. Separate hardware means more cost. Since here you are making use of a single bus, so it is cheaper. So no memory alignment problem here. And since data and program memories are stored physically in different locations, no chances of accidental data corruption. What do you mean, Manish? In hard code architecture, you can see code memory and data memory are physically separate. Physically separate means there is a separate chip for code memory, there is a separate chip for data memory. So hence, there is no mixing of code and data accidentally. So that is not possible. But in Harvard, that is possible. See here, the code and data memory, they are not physically separate. They are, you can say, logically separate. So logical means it is just like an understanding. That's all. So there is a logical barrier after which there is, you can say, it is reserved for data, and before that it is reserved for code. So this logical separation, so since it is logical and it is not physical, so there is a chance of, you can say, data corruption. So suppose code memory can be corrupted if you write the data onto the code memory. So next is Big Indian versus Little Indian. So this we already know. So what is this Big Indian and Little Indian? So suppose you have the data here. What is the data? 10203040. And suppose it is Little Indian. So what will happen is, so suppose you want to store this data starting from the memory location 2000. So you cannot store all this data in one location. Why? Because this is a 32-bit data. You can see it's a hexadecimal data. So, and you can see it's a 32-bit data. So 10 it is 8 bits, 20 again 8 bits, 30 8 bits, and 40 8 bits, totally 32. So to store this, you require 4 locations. Totally you require 4 locations. Okay. So how this will be stored? So out of this, this 40 is the is considered as byte 0. And this 30 is byte 1, 20 is byte 2, and 10 is byte 3. So in Little Indian, what happens is this byte 0 will be stored first, byte 0. Okay, so byte 0 is 40, so 40 will be stored first. Where? In which location? 2000. So next, in location 2001, byte 1 will be stored. What is the byte 1? 30. So 30 will be stored in byte 1. Okay, so in location 2002, so next byte, what is that? 20. So this is byte 2, will be stored in 2002, and the last location 2003, the last byte, which is byte 3, which is 10. So this will be stored here. So this is how the data is stored if it is Little Indian. So what will happen is the lower byte will be stored in lower address. So that is what is the concept of Little Indian. Lower byte is stored in lower address. Okay, so same thing if it is in Big Indian, what will happen? So the concept of Big Indian is lower byte will be stored in higher address. Okay, so here, so which is the lower byte? 40. That is the lower byte. So it is byte 0. So that will be stored here in higher address. You can see the address here, 2003. So next, the next lower byte, which is the next lower byte, which is 30. This is the byte 1. Next byte 2 is 20, and next byte 3 is 10. So this is how it will be stored. Okay, so the concept of Big Indian is the lower byte is stored at the higher address. Okay, so this is what is the Big Indian and Little Indian. So next concept is load store operation and instruction pipeline. What is this? Load store. So why you use load store? So yeah, we already discussed the differences between RISC and CISC. So in RISC, more number of registers are there, and the operations, that is whatever the data manipulation operation, data you can say manipulation operations, they take place on registers, not on memory. So if you want to do memory operations, only two instructions are used: load and store. So that is what, load and store. So in RISC, load and store are used for access memories. Okay. So it's given an example here. what is the example? So load R1 comma X. So what is this? X is a memory location. So we're trying to move that contents of that location to register R1. So then load R2 comma Y. So again, Y is a memory location here. We have to move the contents of Y to R2. So what is the content? 7F. So R1 is having 00 and R2 will have 7F. And once the operands are in the registers, then only the data operation will be done, because it is RISC architecture. So you cannot directly operate on the memory. You cannot write add X comma Y, because X comma Y, they are memory locations. So first you have to copy the contents to registers, and then only you can do the operation. What is the operation? Add R3 comma R1 comma R2. So R2 and R1 are added and the result is in R3. So now this R3 contents then will be stored back to the memory. Which location? The location is Z. So whatever the result will be stored back to memory. So this is what is load store. So next is instruction pipeline. So we already seen this instruction pipeline. What is that? See, in conventional systems, what will happen is the operation cycle is fetch, decode, execute. So to execute any instruction, there are three parts: fetch, decode, execute. First, you have to fetch the instruction from the memory or whatever, wherever it is stored, and then decode it. So what is decode? So because the processor doesn't understand, so suppose you fetch 0010, that is what you have fetched. So you have to decode it. What is the meaning of 0010? So it can be add, or it can be subtract, or it can be multiply. So something, it will mean something. So that is what is the decode part. So you will decode 0010 to, let's say, add. So that is what is decode. And then comes the execute part. So suppose it is add, so we will add two operands using the ALU and store the result somewhere. So these are the three, you can say, parts of instruction execution. So in conventional program, once fetch and decode operations are performed, the hardware is free. So you can see the memory address bus is available after decode, and if it is possible to effectively utilize it for instruction fetch, that is the next instruction. So you can see the example here, machine cycle 1, 2 and 3. So in machine cycle 1, what is happening is, you can see already a particular instruction is being executed. Okay, so it is already being executed, but at the same time the bus is free, memory bus is free. So since the memory bus is free, you can use the memory bus to fetch the next instruction. While the current instruction is being executed, you can fetch the next instruction, which will save the time. How it will save the time? You can see whenever you go to the next machine cycle, what will happen is, so since you have already fetched the next instruction, you can execute it here, since you already fetched it. And at the same time, since the address bus is free now, you can fetch the next instruction. Okay, so you can see two operations are performed simultaneously. So one instruction is being executed, at the same time the next instruction is being fetched. So this will save time. So this is what is instruction pipeline. So I had already explained this in the class. Yeah, so let's conclude this lecture one here, and we'll go with lecture 2 in the coming videos. Thank you.